Chapter 8 of Bindle by Herbert Jenkins. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Recording by Don W. Jenkins. Chapter 8. The Great Conspiracy. 1. At Harridge's stores, Bindle had made himself very popular with the manager of the furniture-removing department. His cheery outlook on life, his racy speech, and general trustworthiness resulted in his being frequently entrusted with special jobs where reliability was required. When the order was received to supply the refreshments for the Barton Bridge Temperance Fete, Bindle was selected to go down to erect the marquee and stalls, and be generally responsible for the safe transit of the eatables and drinkables.
"Yer can always trust me with lemonade and religion," he had assured the manager. "I don't touch neither. They sort of goes to me head."
The Barton Bridge Temperance Society had determined to celebrate the 25th anniversary of its foundation in a manner that should attract to it the attention of the temperance world. After much deliberation and heart-burning, an English rustic fete had been decided upon. The whole of the surrounding country had been put under contribution, and everyone had responded either with generosity or with scorn. Old Sir Builder, of Builder's Entire, had replied with ponderous humour that he would supply all the ale required. When he received a request for 3 gross of pint bottles of a particular kind of temperance ale, he had been surprised.
"Well, I'm damned!" was his comment.
But being a sportsman, he had sent the ale, which he regarded as a fair price for a good story. Barton Bridge was proud of its temperance society, but prouder still of its breadth of mind. It had been a tradition for a quarter of a century that the society should be non-sectarian. It is nothing to the discredit of Barton Bridge that the Temperance Society was the only thing in the place that had not been warped from its orbit by sect. For a churchman to be discovered eating bread of Mr. Lacey's baking, Mr. Lacey being a nonconformist, would have meant social ostracism. He must, by virtue of his beliefs, masticate none but bread kneaded and baked by Mr. Carter, the church baker. A one-time vicar had sought to demolish this ridiculous wall of prejudice by dealing alternately with church and chapel tradesmen. There had been no protest from the chapel people, but the indignation of the church tradesmen had been so great, and their absence from service so persistent, that the vicar had been forced to give way. Tolerance was an acquired habit rather than an instinctive virtue in Barton Bridge, and the temperance meetings were solemn minglings of bodies accompanied by a warring of souls. A witty Frenchman has said that, in order to preserve the purity of his home life, the Englishman invented the continental excursion. It is a cynicism, but at least it shows how dear tradition is to the Englishman's heart. It was this same spirit of tradition that raised above the strife of sect the Barton Bridge Temperance Society. The question of the doctor was another instance of the effect of tradition upon what at first glance might appear to be a grave problem. There was not room for 2 doctors at Barton Bridge, and no doctor could reasonably be expected to be bi-religionist. It therefore became the accepted thing that the Barton Bridge doctor should attend neither church nor chapel, but it was incumbent upon him to become a member of the Temperance Society. The catering for the Temperance Fete had at first presented a serious difficulty, and at one time had even threatened to divide the camp. The church party recoiled in horror from the thought of eating nonconformist sandwiches, whilst if the lemonade were of church manufacture it would mean that scores of dissenters would have a thirsty afternoon. The problem had been solved by Lady Knob Carrick, who insisted that the order should be placed with a London firm of caterers, which, as a limited company, could not be expected to have religious convictions. Thus it was that the order went to Harridge's stores. 2. By 8 o'clock on the morning of the fete, a pantechnicon was lumbering its ungainly way along the Portsmouth Road. Bindle sat meditatively on the tailboard, smoking and obviously bored. With the wholesome contempt of an incorrigible cockney, he contemplated the landscape.
"Edges, trees, and fields, and a mile to walk for a drink. Not me," he muttered, relighting his pipe with solemn gravity.
As the pantechnicon rumbled its ponderous way through hamlet and village, Bindle lightly tossed a few pleasantries to the rustics, who stood aside to gaze at what, to them, constituted an incident in the day's monotony of motor cars and dust. The morning advanced, and Bindle grew more direct in his criticisms on, and contempt for, the bucolic life. At last, out of sheer loneliness, he climbed up beside the driver.
"How'd yer like to live here, old son?" he inquired pleasantly, as they approached a tiny hamlet where a woman, a child, and some ducks and chickens seemed to be the only living inhabitants.
"All right, with a bit of land,"
responded the driver, looking about him appreciatively. Bindle gazed at his colleague curiously, then, feeling that they had nothing in common regarding the countryside, continued,
"Funny thing, you and me coming to a temperance fete."
Then, regarding the driver's face critically, he proceeded,
"Hope you've got your vanity case, will yer? You'll want to powder that nose of yours for the ladies come. Course it's indigestion, only they mightn't believe it."
The driver grunted.
"Fancy," continued Bindle, "having to all about chairs and make up tables a day like this, and on lemonade, too. Can't yer see it, mate? In glass bottles, with lemons stuck in the tops, and no froth?"
The driver grumbled in his throat. The start had been an early one, and he was dry, despite several ineffectual attempts to allay his thirst at wayside inns. It was nearly 11 o'clock before a sprinkling of houses warned them that they were approaching Barton Bridge. Soon the Pantechnicon was awaking echoes in the drowsy old High Street. Halfway along what is practically the only thoroughfare stands the Pack Horse, outside which the driver instinctively pulled up, and he and Bindle clambered down and entered, ostensibly to inquire the way to the fete ground. Behind the bar stood Mr. Cutts, wearing the inevitable red knitted cap without which no one had ever seen him during business hours. He was engaged in conversation with Dick Little, the doctor's son, and by common consent the black sheep of Barton Bridge. The subject of their talk was temperance. He showed no particular inclination to come forward, and Bindle was extremely thirsty. After regarding the red cap for a moment, Bindle approached the landlord.
"No offence, Your Holiness. Sorry to be a nuisance, but can yer tell me where the temperance fete is to be held? Me and my mate is delegates come all the way from London. No, Your Holiness is wrong. It's indigestion. That nose of his always takes a lot of explaining."
Mr. Cutts flushed a deep purple at the reference to his cap. He wore it to hide his baldness and was extremely sensitive. Dick Little laughed outright. It was he who answered Bindle.
"Half a mile up and down the avenue of poplars."
"Do yer hear, mate?" Bindle turned to the driver. "Do yer know a poplar when yer see it? Same for me."
The last remark referred to the driver's order for a pint of ale. After finishing his draught, the driver went out to see to the watering of his horses, whilst Mr. Cutts, having cast at Bindle a look which he conceived to be of withering scorn, retired to his parlour.
"Seem to have hurt old Bung's feelings," Bindle remarked genially to Dick Little.
"You said you were going to the temperance fete?"
"Yes, we're carrying along the buns, sandwiches, cakes, and lemonade, likewise tents and things."
"Like a drink?" inquired Little.
"Well," grinned Bindle judicially as he surveyed his empty glass, "it would lay the dust a bit, provided," he added with mock gravity, "it ain't a split soda. Never could digest split sodas. Where's His Holiness?" he inquired, looking round.
"Never mind him," responded Little, taking a flask from his pocket. "Wash the glass out."
Bindle did so, and threw the water in a delicate line upon the floor. Little emptied the greater part of the contents of the flask into the glass held before him. With a happy look in his eyes, Bindle took a short drink, tasted the liquid critically, looked at Little, then, with a puzzled expression, emptied the glass at the second attempt.
"What yer call it, sir? It's new to me," he remarked, as he replaced his glass upon the counter.
"It hasn't got a name yet. I make it myself. It's not bad, eh?"
"It beats all I've ever tasted, sir. It ain't for sucking babes, though. Pretty strong."
"Yes, you said you had lemonade for the temperance fete in there, didn't you?" inquired Little.
"Well, not exactly, sir. It's got to be watered down, see? There'll be about 50 gallons, sides bottled stuff."
"Are you open to earn a sovereign?" asked Little.
"Well, sir, it's funny you should arst that. Just 'fore I came away from 'ome this morning, my missus told me the income tax paper had come in. That old Lloyd George is fairly messin' up my estates. Yes, I don't mind if I do."
At this moment the driver put his head in at the door and muttered something about getting on.
"'Arf a mo, old son," responded Bindle, then, turning to Little, added with a grin, "'I makes it a rule never to keep me 'orses waitin', mister. The coachman gets so cross.'
When Mr. Cutts returned to the bar, he saw Dick Little in deep conversation with Bindle, which surprised him. He saw Bindle's face irradiating joy and heard him remark,
"'Old me, somebody! Old me, I say! You just leave it to me, sir!'
Presently they both went out. A moment later the pantechnicon rumbled off, leaving Mr. Cutts still wondering. The pantechnicon lumbered on towards the meadow adjoining Carrick Castle, which had been placed at the disposal of the Committee of the Temperance Society by its owner. On the tailboard sat Bindle, a metamorphosed Bindle. All the morning's gloom had vanished from his features, giving place to a joy not entirely due to the partial quenching of a persistent thirst. Dick Little walked slowly home to an early lunch. He had many old scores to settle with Barton Bridge, and he realized that there was an excellent chance of a balance being struck that afternoon. His one anxiety was lest his father should be involved. Between Dr. Little and his two sons, Dick and Tom, there was little in common save a great bond of affection. Dr. Little was serious-minded, inclined to be fussy, but of a generous nature and a genial disposition that gained for him the regard of all his patients. His son Dick was a rollicking dandy, an inveterate practical joker, and the leader of every mischievous escapade at St. Timothy's Hospital, known as Tim's, where he enjoyed an all-round popularity. 3. By 1:30 everything was ready for the temperance fete. The large marquee had been erected, the chairs and tables had been dotted about the meadow. Rustic stalls, gay with greenery and bunting, invited the visitor to refresh himself. In the center of a roped-off space stood a gaily beribboned maypole. A cokernut shy, a Punch and Judy show, and the old English game of Aunt Sally were some of the diversions provided. There was also to be Morris dancing, the dancers having been trained by Miss Slocum, the vicar's daughter, aided for reasons of policy rather than individual prowess, by Miss McPhee, the sister of the congregational minister. The girl attendants in their gaily colored dresses and sunbonnets, and the men in smock frocks and large straw hats, added picturesqueness to the scene. Bindle's activity had been prodigious. With the ease of a man who is thoroughly conversant with his subject, he had taken charge of the drink department. The lemonade had been distributed to the various stalls, and the right amount of water added according to the directions upon each cask. Every drop of water had been fetched under the supervision of Bindle himself. On arriving at the fete ground, Bindle had gone direct to a corner of the meadow and brought forth 6 stone jars, each capable of holding about 2 gallons. The contents of these he had carefully poured into the casks containing the nucleus of the lemonade. These same jars had been subsequently used for fetching water with which to weaken the lemonade. Finally, they had been stowed away in the far end of the pantechnicon. Bindle stood out in strong relief from the other workers, both on account of his costume and personality. He wore the green baize apron of his class. On his head was the inevitable cricket cap. His face had taken on the same hue as his nose, and the smile that irradiated his features transcended in its joyous abandon the smiles of all the others. For everyone he had a merry word. In the short space of 2 hours he had achieved an astonishing popularity. By 3 o'clock the fete was in full swing. Every stable in Barton Bridge was full, and the High Street presented a curious appearance with its rows of horseless carriages, carts, and traps. The coach-houses and available sheds had all been utilized to give shelter to the scores of horses. The members of the committee, wearing big dark blue rosettes, smiled largely their satisfaction. They knew that reporters were present from the Blue Ribbon News and the Pure Water World. Bindle had entered into the spirit of the revelry in a way that attracted him to the attention of many members of the organizing committee.
"'An extremely droll fellow, quite a valuable addition to our attendance,'
the vicar remarked to the Reverend Andrew McPhee, the young congregational pastor, as they stood surveying the scene.
"'An admirable man, Mr. Slocum,'
the cautious Scot had replied.
I have no wish to be uncharitable, but I mistrust his nose."
Entirely unconscious that he was a subject of conversation between the two shepherds of Barton Bridge, Bindle was standing behind a refreshment stall that he had appropriated to himself, surrounded by an amused crowd of revellers. He was discoursing upon the virtues of lemonade upon a hot day.
"Give her a drink, sir,"
he called to one sheepish-looking rustic who stood grasping in his the hand of a lumpy, red-faced girl.
"Give her a drink, sir, do, or she'll faint. Her tongue's almost hanging out as it is. Be a sport. No, miss, it's no use your looking at me. My wife won't let me."
As they took their first sip of the much-praised lemonade, many looked wonderingly at Bindle. There was about it an unaccustomed something that they could not quite analyze or describe. Whatever it was pleasant to the taste, and it gave them courage. Eyes that had previously been sheepish became merry, almost bold. The prospect of joy seemed nearer. The fame of the lemonade soon spread. The fringes about the stalls deepened. The air became bright with shouts and laughter. A spirit of wild revelry was abroad. The coconut shy was the center of an uproarious throng. Balls were bought and flung with such wildness that none dared replace the coconuts that had been knocked off, or to fetch what by rights was his own property. Mr. Slocum and Mr. McPhee strolled round the grounds, sedately benign. They, the representatives of a higher power, must of necessity keep aloof from such pleasures, even temperance pleasures. Still, they were glad to see about them evidences of such simple and wholesome gaiety. With measured steps they approached a considerable group of young people who were laughing and shouting boisterously. When within about 20 yards of the crowd, it suddenly opened out.
"It's a race, sir!"
shouted someone, and they smilingly stood aside to see the sport. A moment after, their smiles froze upon their faces and gave place to a look of wonder and horror. It was indeed a race, but such a race! Coming towards them were 5 youths, each bearing, pick-a-back fashion, a girl. There was an exhibition of feminine frilleries that caused the reverend gentleman to gasp, to look at each other quickly, and then turn hurriedly aside. When just opposite to where they stood, one couple came to the ground, and the pair following immediately behind fell over the others. Mr. McPhee blushed, and Mr. Slocum, remembering his companion's youth, gripped him by the arm and hurried him away with a muttered, "Dreadful, dreadful!" No other word was spoken until they reached the refreshment stall over which Bindle presided, and then the vicar once more murmured, "Dreadful!"
"Have you any tea?"
inquired Mr. McPhee, more from a desire to say something than a feeling of thirst.
"No, sir," responded Bindle. "Tea's over there, sir. Try the lemonade, sir. It's A1. It'll pull you together, sir. Do try it, sir," Bindle added eagerly. "You look hot and tired, sir. It'll do your good."
The two pastors looked curiously at Bindle, but accepted each without comment a glass of lemonade. They put it to their lips, tasted it, looked at each other, and then drank greedily.
"Another, sir?"
inquired Bindle of the vicar when he had finished his glass.
"No,"
murmured Mr. Slocum, but Bindle had already refilled his glass and was doing a like service for Mr. McPhee. When they left the stall it was arm in arm, and Mr. McPhee directed his steps to the spot where, a few minutes previously, he had received so severe a shock. But the sport was over, and the crowd had dispersed. End of Chapter 8. Read by Don W. Jenkins, Rancho San Diego, California, shaggybark.blogspot.com.